Well, hello, everyone, and welcome to a special conversation that we have today with author Kate Andersen Brower, who has written a terrific book, Exploring the White House, and it is directed at younger readers. And I'm thrilled to talk with her today. My name is Anita McBride. I'm on the board of the White House Historical Association, and I chair the Education Committee. So this type of book is exactly in our wheelhouse and really our mission of reaching interested students of history of all ages. So, Kate, I'd like to tell you a little bit about you for everyone. You covered the White House as a reporter, of course, for Bloomberg News during the administration of President Barack Obama. And you've since written four books about the White House, all of them terrific, including two of them that are New York Times bestsellers. But today we're here to discuss your newest book, Exploring the White House Inside America's Most Famous Home. What I love about this book and what all of us at the Historical Association loved about this book, it's a great opportunity for young readers to learn more about the wonderful people that work in the White House residence, especially that support every first family. So thank you for joining me today, Kate.
Thank you, Anita. I always love talking with you, and doing anything with the White House Historical Association is an honor. So thank you so much.
You're very welcome. Thank you for helping promote White House history. I think our listeners, before we dive into a lot about your book, I think our listeners would be interested in hearing a little bit about your own experience to working as a reporter in the White House and what you can tell us about that experience of covering, you know, arguably one of the most famous places in the world and certainly an important place in history in our country.
Well, I remember when I worked at Bloomberg, I would call you, Anita, occasionally and ask for quotes and insight into how the First Lady's office is run, because I did a lot of covering of Michelle Obama. And, you know, it was a fascinating experience, as you know, getting to travel on Air Force One and getting to actually see history in the making, seeing the president signing the healthcare overhaul. I mean, all these incredible moments in history, you get to be a witness to them. So I think as a career, it was truly incredible. And I started out as a TV producer, and I asked my boss, Al Hunt, at the time at Bloomberg, if he needed anybody to do weekends, to sit in the pool vans, as you know, when President Bush would go golfing or running or whatever, and when Obama would go golfing, they need people there in case something happens. And so that's what I ended up doing when the full-time reporters were exhausted from working all week. They needed somebody to sit and just watch Marine One take off from the South Lawn on the way to Camp David, you know, things like that. And that was at the tail end of the Bush administration. Mm-hmm. And then I ended up fortunately getting to cover President Obama full time.
And I think one of the examples, and if I understood from sort of reading your interest in writing this book, is when you were sitting in one of those pool vans, press pool vans, just sort of waiting for, you know, the action to happen or the president to come out, that you had actually witnessed one of the White House resident staffers trying to control the Obama's dog, Bo, and to get the dog either on Marine One, or maybe you were already at Andrews and trying to get the dog on Air Force One. And so you were really bearing witness to one of the interesting roles that a White House resident staff member plays, and it intrigued you about life in the White House, and that really was one of the origins of you wanting to write this young reader's book. Is that true?
It's true, yeah, and it's especially, you know, when thinking about kids and what kids like, and thinking about animals and dogs, and you know, it was on Air Force One on the way to Martha's Vineyard, and the dog and Bo was running up and down the aisle, and they were trying to kind of corral him to come up, because you know the press where the press sits is at the back of the plane.
That's
he kept
right.
running back, and that for kids is just a great I think way into the story, that these are human beings, obviously, we don't get to see that softer side. And one of the great things about the Obama daughters, they were so young. I believe it was 7 and 10, right? When they came into
when
the
they came.
And then the thing that I wanted to also focus on was that transition. And you, Anita, and also several people on Michelle Obama's staff said it was the best transition in memory. You know, that they couldn't imagine an easier transition from the Bush, the Obama White House. And a lot of that was, I think, you know, Jenna and Barbara Bush coming and giving the tour to Sasha and Malia, and just this feeling of community that was created. And I think that kids like that.
I just feel every first lady through history has left some mark on this role. And clearly for us at the White House Historical Association, we're indebted to Jackie Kennedy and First Lady Jackie Kennedy, and having established the White House Historical Association, which of course, you know, Americans know her as a style icon, of course, devoted and dedicated to the preservation, restoration of the White House. But she also would want to be known as, you know, having an expansive knowledge of history, and she wanted Americans to know their history. And starting with the White House was the one place or the one symbol of our nation that she felt Americans should be connected to. So again, you are contributing to that by writing a book that appeals to young readers and bringing some of these little stories to life. So I'd like to ask you about a couple of those that you talk about in the book. That, you know, all of us, even if we worked in the White House, and I worked there three different times, I'm always learning new things. And I learned something fun from your book that I didn't know before about the Johnsons, Lady Bird Johnson and President Johnson, that when the family went to Camp David, you know, with Lucy and Linda, their daughters, they would make the girls pay for their own meals of what they ate at Camp David. And I think most people in America still don't know that a president and their family pay for their meals in the White House. They're given a bill every month for what they eat, what they drink. But the Johnsons felt, now their girls were teenagers and they were old enough to pay their own way. That's an incredible story. I mean, can you share other little stories like that that kind of paint this window into the inner workings of a family that lives in the house?
I love that story too. I mean, you know, I'm really interested in that solarium, the room on the third floor of the White House. Sure. That's this big sort of family room and has changed over from one administration to the next. And, you know, when the Kennedys left, suddenly the Johnsons turned the solarium, which had been a kindergarten for Caroline Kennedy, into kind of a teenage hangout, you know, because they were young adults. I do remember one of the Johnson daughters, and Lucy, I'm sure you have worked with her before, is just incredible. She has this vivid
memories.
You know, and the way she describes the staff, and she can down to the expressions on their faces. I mean, it's very, I think Lady Bird Johnson is one of my favorite first ladies. The White House diary that she wrote is incredible. And what an incredible writer, and everything she speaks in poetry, really. And Lucy also does. And so she described how, you know, they had a fireplace in their bedroom for the first time. And she thought, oh, this is so, you know, extravagant to have a fireplace in my bedroom. And she lit a fire. She had a friend come over and smoke started billowing out. And, you know, there was all this soot and she started to panic. And the staff came in and helped clean. And Lady Bird found out about this and said, oh, no, you know, you're going to have to go back in there and clean it up too. This is your mess too. And I think that's like a parenting thing, right? And we all know that Michelle Obama made her daughters make their beds every day, you know, and this sense of trying to have your kids not be spoiled in the White House. And I think that's a huge, I can't imagine the challenge that is.
I think, you know, you're right. And when you're talking about that, about the Johnson girls' experience, you know, with the fireplace and, of course, making this mess, it reminded me too of, you know, Barbara Bush on Inauguration Day, January 1989. The family had just, you know, come back from the parade after the swearing in, and they were all having a family meal. And I believe, I don't know if it was in the family dining room or even in the East Room, because it's such a big family. But she noticed that Barbara and Jenna were missing. And turns out they were in the bowling alley, sort of bowling, but they had called one of the resident staffers to bring them something to eat. And Barbara Bush found out about it and was furious. This is why they call her the enforcer, and went down there and told them in no uncertain terms that they are never to do that, you know, again, and asked the resident staff to bring something, you know, to them. So again, to your point of, you are surrounded by 95 people that are there to take care of you and everything that you need, but there are limits, as yeah, particularly when you're young children, as to, you know, what's right and what's not.
Yeah, I think it's very challenging. I think for the Obamas, having Marian Robinson, having Michelle, yes, Obama's mother there was hugely helpful. Right. And they were, you know, there was Smiley St. Aubin, who was a butler there.
Wonderful man.
Yeah, and he was from Haiti, I believe, and he was, you know, spoke French fluently, and Michelle Obama would have him help her daughters. At the very beginning, he passed away shortly after they moved in, but those first few months, he was teaching them French and speaking French to them, and she was also having, asking the florist to label the flower, mm-hmm, arrangements so that her daughters could learn about the different kinds of flowers. And I just thought little things like that are very important, because you're taking advantage of the knowledge of the resident staff too.
Absolutely. And I think there also that Chelsea Clinton, when she was there, was very, you know, interested in cooking. I think it was a vegetarian, and sort of worked with the chef at the time to learn more, to be down in the kitchen learning how to cook, you know, with him. That's a wonderful sort of example and experience for the White House resident staff to have with the first family as well. You know, moments like that where they're, you know, helping them, particularly young people, helping them grow up in a home, you know, like this. This is why they all become very close. And the departure day, whether it's after 4 years or 8 years, for the resident staff and a first family, is very emotional.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's not a dry eye in the house, right? When they are going around and the president and the first lady are saying goodbye to the people that they got to know over 8 years, you know. And I even would talk to people like Chris Limerick, who was the head housekeeper, who described, mm-hmm, being very emotional herself, and the sense that you were having a new job all of a sudden, this turnover of not knowing what's expected of you, what's wanted. I mean, I think that, as you say, with Jill Biden and President Biden, they're known, we know about what they might like. The staff has a sense of them, having seen them before. They didn't live at the White House. Obviously, they were in the observatory. But, there are ways of finding out what they like for breakfast, right?
Yeah.
Whereas, whereas I think with the Clintons, I had a story about the chef Roland Mesnier, who was, you know, the pastry chef, sure, and he just didn't know.
No.
What, definitely. And he flew in bagels from New York, and that they thought he had heard that they liked bagels. I mean, the fact that they'll just do anything to please the family.
That's actually a good reminder of the preparation, you know, that it takes to prepare for a new family to come in, and as much information that they could officially get ahead of time helps for day one. But otherwise, you are right. They're scouring newspapers. They're you know, watching news reports, anything that they can get their hands on of what the president, first lady, family might like. So that on day one, it feels like it's their home. And right, that's a daunting responsibility. And I think there's something very comforting about the stability of the White House. And a lot of it is due to the residents' staff. They just roll with the punches, and it's really incredible.
And that's what I try to do in this book, too, because I think kids – so the book is geared for 8 to 12-year-olds, and they're very visual. I mean, kids, you know, want to see the layout of the White House. They want to see a flow chart of – so I have a map of the inside of the White House and then also a flow chart of how it actually works. You know, you have the president and the first lady. Then you have the chief usher. Then you have ushers below them and the different departments. And there is something, like you say, that's comforting about the stability and the fact that this is going to happen no matter who is in office.
But speaking of children, I'm sure there will be, you know, people of all ages that will be listening to this and watching this program. But children will, you know, listen to you talk about being a reporter, working there, then really, you know, writing these great books and think to themselves too, well, you know, what I may want to work in the White House someday. And you've worked with political staff of, you know, specific presidents, and you've met so many of the permanent resident staff that work there for generations. Do you have any kind of advice for young Americans that might want to pursue an opportunity to work inside the White House one day?
That's such a great question. I think find out what you want to do and then go after it. Like, there's nothing in your way, right? If you, and each job, as you know, is so different. If you are interested in managing a staff and being in charge, I mean, the chief usher of the White House is essentially the general manager of the house, right? So if you're up for a job like that, or if you love to cook, you know, I think that that would be a fascinating job to have. But I think the policy side too, what you did, Anita, is to me just one of the most key things, because you're really shaping the legacy of the First Lady, right? And that's what is going to live on for hundreds and hundreds of years, and historians are going to look back on. I think that's just a super important part of it. And obviously journalism, I am a huge a proponent of, and I think it's so important that people continue to ask questions and look to uncover the truth and record history and talk to people. I mean, I think that's one of the things. I start these books with the Kennedys because you're trying to get these people who are at the end of their lives, and there are some people left who remember what Jackie Kennedy was like in the White House, but that's quickly a dwindling group. And so I think it's so important to just ask questions of older people. You know, Nelson Pierce was a White House usher, and I describe, you know, I went to his house in Arlington. He was in his 90s at the time, sitting on his front porch with his wonderful wife. They had several children, describing what it was like being summoned to teach Caroline Kennedy how to do a somersault in the residence. And I mean, to him, it was just kind of a funny story. But to me, it was just like, wow, someone needs to write this down and remember it for the future. So I think that as long as writers and journalists keep asking people questions and sitting down with older people and asking them about their lives, I mean, I'm sure we all wish we had talked to our grandparents more before they passed.
Absolutely. Right? What would be the one thing, and it's hard to ask a question like that, but the one thing you would want young readers or readers of all ages, but particularly young readers, to come away with remembering from your book?
Well, I mean, at this moment in history, when we're living through the worst, you know, pages of a history book, really, we're going through them as we speak with the pandemic. I think it's important to remember the absolute devotion and hard work and honesty and discretion that is still important today, right? It's in loyalty. All those things that are part of what the resident staff hold dear. I think it's important for kids to not be nonchalant about these things or not think that they don't matter anymore, that kindness and dedication and resilience and all those wonderful qualities that these people have. And loyalty above all, you know, even when they told me stories that were negative about the periods in history that were challenging during scandals and what have you, they always said it sympathetically and said, look, this is a difficult life for the kids and for the families. And I think it's also empathy that the staff has, the feeling of wanting to protect the president and their family. I love that. And so I think it's an uplifting look at our democracy and the White House and how it runs. And I think it's just interesting because I even as a reporter covering the White House, didn't realize that there are basement floors with a whole team of people putting flower arrangements together and things like that. So it's just behind the curtain, a little Downton Abbey at the White House for kids.
That's right. And you brought that to life beautifully in this book. And of course, all of your great work in documenting first ladies, the residents, staff, the first in line. I mean, your book about the vice presidents. I mean, it's really helping to paint a full picture in an interesting way. And I think you just gave a great life lesson to young readers and young watchers of this program today about loyalty and discretion and not passing judgment. The resident staff are the few people around a president and the family that are not there to opine on what their public life or public work might be, but really to make their life as easy as possible while they're in the toughest of positions. And I think I really want to thank you for joining us today and sharing your book. It was really great to hear your stories. And I also want to tell people how they can get your book. So would you like to share that with us and maybe show the cover of, because you have the hard copy of it now?
Yeah, I do. And I also, of course, want to thank you, Anita, and the White House Historical Association. But more importantly, it's so helpful to have people like you who have worked in administrations talking to journalists. I think that's really crucial because, just giving background on how it works. Because otherwise, you don't really know. It's hard to get a sense of it. So here's the book.
Beautiful cover.
In the back has a two little girls on the South Lawn playing with a dog in the tree house, which Amy Carter had on the South Lawn.
That's
of the
right.
White House, sort of. And you can get the book on Amazon, but I also think it's really important to support local bookstores right now. So Politics and Prose is a great one.
Here in Washington, D.C.
Right here in Washington. I mean, it is available at Barnes & Noble and the big stores, but I think now more than ever we need to support local bookstores because the pandemic has made it really hard for them. And Politics and Prose has a fabulous website. So I would encourage people to go there. I also have some questions at the end of the book, and I really fought hard to get those in there because it's questions to get you thinking. And I wanted kids to be able to, as a parent, I think it's a great thing to be able to say to kids, what would your Secret Service code name be, right? Like, and go through the list. I kind of, have fun with it too.
I like that you did a description of that, and that also you had a list of all the names of the pets that presidents have had. So it's all right here in the book, and the fun facts that are throughout is really just great, even for older readers like myself. But on behalf of the White House Historical Association, we want to thank you, Kate, for helping contribute to the rich history, which is ours as Americans, about the White House, about the people who have worked and lived there. As you say, it's really important that this be documented. So thank you for that very, very much.